these reaction centers lose electrons, what we have to call the process? Oxidation. So in oxidation condition, this not receive light energy further. So whenever these electrons move back and reaches to these PS1, PS2 reaction centers, then what happens? Again, they will be reduced. Then in that state, again, they can get sunlight. So then finally, what happens to these protons? These protons sometimes accumulate in the thylakoid membrane only. After some time, whenever their concentration increase, they move to stroma. Stroma means lipid portion of the chloroplast. Okay, so at that time, when any substance move high concentration to low concentration, then the substances lose some energy. By using that energy, ADP converts into ATP and NADP converts into NADPH. So these two are energy sources for dark reactions. In the dark reaction, glucose will form. To form glucose, some energy is needed. That energy actually comes from this ATP and NADPH. After this, you have to write in the light reactions. While you are explaining light reactions, these main steps you have to explain. Now we are going to see dark reactions. Okay. Already I gave the definition of dark reactions. Dark reactions means what? So photosynthetic reactions which occurs either in presence of light or in absence of light, that reactions are called dark reactions. These dark reactions also known as Kelvin cycle, because Melvin Kelvin, a scientist, given all these reactions. Okay, that's why on this name we are also calling these reactions as Kelvin cycle. And here what is happening? Glucose is forming, so we call this as biosynthetic phase. And in this reaction, carbon dioxide will be utilized. So these reactions also called as carbon fixation. So in the exams, if asked write about carbon fixation, or ask about explain the Kelvin cycle or biosynthetic phase, for all this answer is the same. For dark reactions only have to write. So already I told you, here we are going to see only some important steps. Okay, so first of all, so what is present in the stroma means ribulose, one, five, diphosphate. Okay, so it is a chemical compound, ribulose 1,5 diphosphate. Where it is located? That is readily available in the stroma, liquid portion of the chloroplast. This will combine with the carbon dioxide. Okay, due to this, what happens means, so actually this is a 5 carbon compound, so to it one carbon will add, and finally what happens means hexose sugar will form. Okay, this hexose sugar is also 6 carbon compound. This is 6 carbon compound. What is happening in the first step? Ribulose 1,5 diphosphate is combined with carbon dioxide. Due to this, what type of compound will form? Hexose sugar will form. So this hexose sugar is most unstable. So most unstable, it cannot remain as it is. That's why after several reactions, it splits into 2-PZA. PZA means phosphoglycerate acid. So this is the 3 carbon compound. So this hexose sugar splits equally into 2 molecules of 3 carbon compound called phosphoglycerate acid. Okay. So next, this PGA, each PGA later on reactions, what happens means that changes into glyceraldehyde three phosphate. Okay. So here we are skipping so many reactions. Just I already told you, here only we are going to see some important steps. Okay, hexose sugar after several reactions changes into phosphoglyceric acid. This phosphoglyceric acid in the next step changes into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Okay, then finally what happens? Two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate finally becomes into glucose, gives glucose, one molecule of glucose. Okay, so two molecules here, this also three carbon compound, such like two molecules combine and form one molecule of glucose. So here to form chemical bonds in between these compounds, what is needed? Energy is needed. Then energy actually come from here. So in the first light reaction, some energy produced in the form of ATP and NADPH. That energy is useful to here to run all these activities and to combine certain kind of compounds to form glucose. Okay, and this is a cyclic reaction. So again, ribulose 1,5-diphosphate should form. So once it continuously consumed, again, where from that ribulose 1,5-diphosphate come? So after certain time, it should complete. But that should not happen. If that should not happen, means what? These actions will continue in a cyclic manner. So how again ribulose 1,5-diphosphate again will form means 10 molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate combine and finally forms 30 carbon compound. Okay, the 30 carbon compound is again mostly unstable, that cannot remain as it is in this condition. So immediately what happens, it splits into 6 molecules of ribulose diphosphate. Okay, ribulose 1,5-diphosphate. Finally, this 30 carbon compound splits equally into 6 molecules of RUBP. RUBP means ribulose 1,5-diphosphate, short form. Okay, so again here, this ribulose 1,5-diphosphate again that will combine carbon dioxide and form hexose, and these cycles will continue like this. Okay, these are all steps involved in dark reactions. Okay, in the dark reactions, what are the main steps? So here you have to remember only a few words only. Ribulose 1,5-diphosphate, hexose sugar, next phosphoglyceric acid, next glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. These words, if you remember, you can give your answer. Here. So what is the first step? Ribulose 1,5-diphosphate combining with the carbon dioxide and forming hexose sugar. This is most unstable compound, hence immediately that splits equally into two molecules of phosphoglyceric acid. After several reactions, this phosphoglyceric acid changes into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate combine means glucose will form. If 10 molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate combine means 30 carbon compound will form. This 30 carbon compound, so in further reactions, splits into 6 molecules of again ribulose 1,5-diphosphate. So here one more point you have to mention, what is that? So to run all these activities, some energy is needed. Then energy comes from ATP and NADPH, which produced in the light reactions. Up to here, you have to write while you are explaining the dark reactions. Okay, so here I have given all these reactions in the form of a flow chart. So, but in your textbook, given in your paragraph. So, if you read all that, so many steps skipped in that. That's why you may not understand. So, it is better to understand in the form of a flow chart. Write all the main steps like a flow chart and read it and explain it, become very easy to you. Okay, so if you directly write means first this and this will give to this, this will give to this, and this will give to this. Okay, this is the flow chart. So if you follow this flow chart, it become very easy to you. So where light reactions takes place? In the thylakoid membrane. Where dark reactions takes place? In the stroma. Okay, so here after this, what is happening? Finally, glucose is forming, and this glucose will transport to various parts of the plant body, and later it converts into starch or proteins and other substances according to plant necessities. Okay, this is about light reactions and dark reactions. So till now I have not asked in the exams in 10th class, but some steps. Okay, I am not saying it is not important in examination point of view. In examination point of view, you also must have to learn all this. But you have to concentrate on each and every step. Okay. So many times asked about this reaction, photolysis. Okay. So this also learn in the form of flowchart, and this also follow in the form of flowchart. It becomes very easy to you. So up to now what we discussed means autotrophic nutrition. So in this first unit, up to now we discussed about autotrophic nutrition. Means we concentrate on photosynthesis. So in this part we learn what is photosynthesis, what is the equation for photosynthesis, and also we saw various experiments related to photosynthesis. First we saw how Priestley found relationship animals and plants. Okay. And later we saw starch, how can we identify starch material in the given substance, and also we discussed how we can prove carbon dioxide is essential for photosynthesis, how light is essential for photosynthesis, and we also learned how we can prove oxygen liberate during the photosynthesis. And we also learned what is the structure of leaf, what is the structure of DS of leaf, what is the structure of chloroplast. Next we discussed about these light reactions and dark reactions. These are the topics up to now we completed in this autotrophic nutrition. So now next part of this lesson is heterotrophic nutrition. I think this is clear to you all. Okay, I'm going to have this. Yeah, now we are going to see heterotrophic nutrition. I think you already know what is heterotrophic nutrition, the meaning of the title. So heterotrophic nutrition means, hetero means various. Tropic means it is a food level in the ecology. A group of organisms show a type of nutrition method, means they get food from other organisms. They don't prepare themselves, okay, whatever material required to them, so they cannot prepare. That's why to get energy, they depend on other organisms. Such all organisms grouped under heterotrophic nutrition. So heterotrophic nutrition means organism which depend on other organism for food. That all comes under heterotrophic nutrition. So heterotrophic nutrition is common, okay, in the animals. But we can see that heterotrophic nutrition even in the plants also. So you know that plants are autotrophs. So that we know. But there are some exceptions. Some kind of plants, what they do, they get food from other organisms. So they are not able to conduct photosynthesis. Then what they do, how they get energy? By depending on other organisms. Okay. So here one example is given to you. That is dodder plant, Cuscuta. The name of scientific name is Cuscuta, generally called as dodder plant or Bambarantiga in Telugu. So how it live, that Cuscuta? Means, for example, first, okay, it will germinate Here is one plant. It is not Cuspita plant, a general plant field. And here field one Cuspita plant germinate. Then after germination, what it do means it start growing towards nearby plant. This is Cuspita plant. After germination, it start growing toward the nearby plant. Then what it do means it make attachment with this plant. Okay, and start straddling around it like this. And it lose its contact with the soil. Now it not has any contact with soil. So it start growing like this only, and it occupies branches all parts of the plant. Then how it get food, how it get water, means this Cuspita plant that grows, just if you see the part of Cuspita field, this is the part of Cuspita. So it appear, it not appear green color because chloroplasts are absent in them. So chloroplasts are absent, that's why it cannot conduct the photosynthesis. Then how it satisfies its energy needs means it get everything from this plant, host plant, this is host plant. How it get everything from it means from this Cuspita nurse some finger-like projections will develop. Okay, so these are some finger-like projections. So here and there what happens means like this, some finger-like projections will grow and they grow inside this plant body. So already you know what is present inside the plant body. For example, feel this is the plant. Okay, this is stem. So now this finger-like projections, these are called as hystoria. So this hystoria penetrates into the host plant body. And what are present here in the middle of the plant, this plant body, xylem and phloem tubules. Already you know what is xylem, what is phloem. Xylem means water transporting tissue of plants called xylem. Food transporting tubules of a plant called as phloem. This hystoria means projections of this Cuspita plant, this is the Cuspita plant. It develops some finger-like projections. Okay. So these finger-like projections penetrates into the plant body and make contact it with the xylem and phloem tubules. And here onwards, everything it takes. So water and food material, glucose. So like that, it depends on this plant. Because of that, what happens? Gradually, this plant will warm and sometimes it may dry up. Then what it do? Simply it creep on another plant. Okay. So after complete death, okay, if there is no chance to get nutrients from this plant, in such conditions, if possible, this plant, this Cuspita plant, goes to another plant, creeps to another plant. So like that, it continues to grow all around that area. Okay, so here this is called heterotrophic nutrition. Why we are calling here this is a heterotrophic nutrition means because this plant taking everything from another plant, host plant. It is not preparing food, it is taking food and also water from it. It depend on it. That's why we call this as heterotrophic plant. Why we have to this as plant? If anything depend on, if any organism depend on other organism for food, we have to call it as animal. But why we are calling this as a plant? Because it has only plant structure. In this also we can see xylem and phloem tubules. Okay, chloroplast is absent. But in other aspects, it look like as plant. It forms seeds that will germinate thereafter. With the body structure and tissue, and it has cell wall. So remaining features are like plant. That's why we call this as a plant, even though it is depending on other organism for food, we are not calling it as animal. Okay, except this remaining all features look like plant. So we consider this as heterotrophic plant. Okay. So in 9th class, I think you studied about some other plants, insectivorous plants. Do you remember what are the names of Cuscuta, Cecilia? Okay. What these are all? Epanthus. These are insectivorous plants. So that insectivorous plants not considered as heterotrophic plants. Okay. Insectivorous plants are different and this Cuscuta heterotrophic plant is different. In which aspect that are different? Means this Cuscuta, so completely depending on other organism, it is not conducting photosynthesis. But if you see insectivorous plants, what they do, they are able to conduct photosynthesis. They have a normal plant structure having root or leaves that having chloroplasts that conduct photosynthesis. But why they take insects? Means for nitrogenous compounds. So generally what we do for healthy growth of plants, we use fertilizers. But that are not economically useful to us and we not give any fertilizers. Then how they get nitrogenous compounds? Nitrogenous compounds are very important to plants. That's why to satisfy the nitrogenous compound, what they do? They take insects. They trap insects. They have different traps, develop modified different traps. Okay. Different body parts modifies into different traps. So by using the traps, they trap insects and they digest them. And from their body onwards, they get nitrogen. So when they get nitrogen, in that time period, they grow rapidly. If they are not able to or if they have failed to trap insects, in that time period, they grow normally. But what happens? They do photosynthesis like normal plants, they grow normally. But at the time of they are taking insects, they grow rapidly. So that insectivorous plants are somehow different from these plants. Okay, Cuscuta like plants. Cuscuta is a complete parasitic plant. What is the meaning of parasite? So this is another type of nutrition. Parasites means in a close association to different group of organisms will live. In that, one organism will get benefit, another organism get harm. Already I think you know symbiosis, already you learned in previous classes. What is symbiosis? That is a type of nutrition. What do you learn about that symbiosis? In that, two different group of organisms live in a close association and will get benefit from one to another. Example, leguminosae family plants and rhizobium bacteria. These are root nodules. Okay, that is called symbiosis. In that, both are getting benefit. But in the parasitism type of nutrition, what happens? In a close, two different group of organisms live together and in their association, one organism get benefit, another organism get harm. So for example, this one. So this is the Cuscuta plant. What is the scientific name? Cuscuta, general name, Dodder plant. And what is this? So this Dodder plant producing some finger-like projections. What is the name of this projection? Hystoria. So hystorians are projections of Cuscuta plant. So this is a big important bit. So what is the name of projections which arise from the plant of Cuscuta body is Hystoria. Or otherwise how Cuscuta plant make contact with the xylem and phloem tubules of host plant is Hystoria. So that we have to remember. Okay. So this is about heterotrophic nutrition in plants. So now we are going to see heterotrophic nutrition in the animals. So animals means all animals heterotrophs only. So they are not able to conduct photosynthesis. For that, what they do? To get energy, they depend on other organisms. That's why we call that as heterotrophs. So in this first given about protozoans, how nutrition takes place in amoeba and next we are going to see paramecium. Later we study how digestion process takes place in human beings. So for example, if you see amoeba, so now we are going to see nutrition in amoeba. So this is the general structure of amoeba. We already know does not have any particular structure. So if you are drawing amoeba, means must you have to draw nucleus. So this is called plasma lemma. Okay, and inside you see some vacuoles, food vacuoles, and some other cytoplasm. We call as sarcoplasm here. Okay, so this is general amoeba. What are these called? Pseudopodia. Pseudopodia means false feet. Actually, they are a locomotor organs. So pseudo means false. Okay, they appear and disappear. So in which direction that will form, anybody cannot expect. In which direction that that move, in that direction continuously pseudopodia will develop and start moving to that side. So this is the general amoeba structure. So now we are going to see how it captures the food and how it digests the food and how it assimilates the food and how it will excrete that undigested material. So for example, film, it is a food particle. Okay, so this amoeba want to eat it. So how this amoeba takes this food material into inside? Means, so first of all it should move towards this side. Then what happens? Then this pseudopodia start developing like this. Okay, it will develop like this. Okay. It, after certain moment, what happens? If this pseudopodia, so the total body comes like this, come to forward, then this pseudopodia start developing like this. Okay. So in the next step, what happens? That both sides of pseudopodia come back. Now what happened? That food particle trapped inside the amoeba body, and this food particle enters into the amoeba body like as a food vacuum. So now what happens? This amoeba start continue to move. So finally what happens? This releases into the body like as a food vacuum. So now the food particle is here inside the food vacuum. Then how it will digest? Means, so this food vacuum, what it will means, that walls of food vacuum start releasing some kind of enzymes over the food particle. So it prepares some kind of enzymes. The walls of food vacuum, what they do, prepare some enzyme chemical substances and they release over this food particle. So the chemicals, enzymes, what they do, they break down this food particle into smaller and smaller pieces. What we call the process? Digestion. What is digestion? Converting of complex molecules into simple molecules is called as digestion. So what is happening here? Digestion. So after digestion, so at the time of digestion, this vacuole will remain here only. It start moving all around the body. So while it is moving, this total process will continue. And finally what happens? This food particle breaks down into smaller and smaller pieces and simple molecules like. So after this, what should be there? If digestion complete, is it get energy? No. After digestion, for example, suppose here is the digested particles. So the digested particles should assimilate into the body. So next step, what is the next step means? After digestion, so the digestive parts come into the cytoplasm. thereafter that utilize it for body activities to produce energy. So if digested food material come to use to body, the process is called assimilation. So after digestion, what is the next step? Assimilation. So after this assimilation, feel still this is the after assimilation, if still if there any part remain, what are these parts? Somehow big in size that are not able to assimilate into the body, then what happens to this? Means simply this will be sent outside. So this vacuum come to this sarcolemma, okay, this place plasmalemma, then it will burst there, then all kind of that undigested material releases to outside. So what is happening here means, so that undigested particle if still remain in the food vacuum that are sending out, what is that process called? Excretion. See, in the single cell of amoeba only, so all process are taking place. So but in our body to do all these works, different organs are there. A specific system, digestive system is developed in higher grade of organisms to do all these works. Some a specific system is developed. But what works carries in the higher grade organism, that all works also carries by this single cell amoeba. Not only amoeba, so we can see the same process in all other protozoans also. What is protozoa? That is a phylum name. All unicellular heterotrophic organisms kept under a specific phylum called protozoa. These protozoans all are unicellular and all are heterotrophic in nature. So in all, okay, protozoans, we can see this process. Of course, this amoeba not have a specific shape, but remaining protozoans having some specific shape. That is the only difference, but the process of digestion, the remaining things are same. Okay, I think you understood how amoeba takes food into inside. One more time I am showing clearly. So this is amoeba. So in the next picture we are showing food particle. So in the next picture what we are doing is we are here it is the food particle, it reaches to the part. Okay, in the next picture what you do means so that turn into the body like as a food vacuum. In the next picture what we show means, so some enzymes release over the food particle. This is the food particle, so some enzymes are secreting on it. So here digestion is taking place. After digestion, what is the next picture? Assimilation. So after assimilation, what happens? So digest and will assimilate. Assimilation means absorbing digested food particle into body is called assimilation. After that, that food particle will come to plasma lemma and releases that undigested particle to outside. This process is called excretion. So if you represent present your answer by using, so by drawing this kind of all pictures, this will become very easy to you to understand and to present your answer. Okay, this is mode of nutrition in amoeba. So amoeba means actually in the exams you won't ask how digestion takes place in amoeba, right? Explain about nutrition in amoeba, may not ask like that. Explain how nutrition takes place in प्रोटोजोआ में आस्क है. व्हाट इज प्रोटोजोआ? प्रोटोजोआ इज द फाइलम नेम ऑफ यूनिसेलुलर ऑर्गेनिज्म विच शो हेटरोट्रोपिक न्यूट्रिएशन. सो दैट नेम प्रोटोजोआ आल्सो यू हैव टू रिमेंबर. प्रोटोजोआ मींस व्हाट? दैट इज द फाइलम नेम. सो दिस अमीबा बिलोंग्स टू फाइलम प्रोटोजोआ. ओके. Yeah, in the next class, we are going to see how nutrition takes place in paramecium. Paramecium.